Blackstone Audio presents Fingerprints of Previous Owners, a novel, by Rebecca Entel. This book is read by Cherise Boothe, Robin Miles, and Ron Butler. For My Parents, Esther and Leonard Entel. Too slow, the stones crawling toward language. Derek Walcott. Pain has an element of blank. Emily Dickinson. There is no place you or I can go to think about or not think about, to summon the presences of or recollect the absences of slaves. There's no small bench by the road. Toni Morrison. Chapter 1. When the planes landed out on the quay, we would gather on the beach. We draped ourselves in sheets, the wind turning us into shifting shapes of brown and white, like sea creatures wrestling our own bleached shells. I'd never arrived here from somewhere northern, frosty, but I imagine that when they filed out of the plane, it was hard not to go rigid, expecting the January cold. The sun would come down to massage their shoulders. They would relax against its warmth and squint through their sunglasses against its glare. From there, they headed to the resort on Furnace Island, though their boarding passes had said the destination was Cruffy. They didn't know what it meant for this place to have two names. I'd never even been on the quay where the resort landed its planes to see the island as a dot out in the ocean. I'd never arrived here from anywhere. When they moved toward a gravelly area labeled baggage claim, a flurry, a team of people with the name of the resort scripted across their chests would appear, arrange its bodies as prosthetics for whatever they needed to do, move luggage, climb into the small boat that awaited them. Scaffolded in wooden masts and adornments, bearing a flag with the resort's sunset logo imprinted over a red and yellow castle. Across its side in regal script, the Pinta. The boat would jostle against the dock, clacking and swishing as they waited to be unmoored. After heaving all of their luggage in a human assembly line onto a twin boat labeled the Nina Luggage, some team members would don felt hats with feathers and put on the bug-eyed faces of actors. Those staff members without costumes, the ones who'd done the lifting, the ones from the island, the ones, like me, would sit down on the floor of the boat and wait. Some of the newly arrived faced toward the island. Some faced backward toward the airport quay or the open water. Their backs would touch. The stepping stone trail of clouds in the sky would lure some of their eyes out to sea, while others would lean away, waving their phones around for a signal, frowning. The boat would begin bobbing along. A throat clearing, followed by a sandy boot planting itself on the beach next to them, bringing all the eyes back. Then the Pinta, the befeathered man would bellow, being faster and in the lead, sighted land. Some of the other men would jump up around him, pointing excitedly at the beach that had been in view even from the quay. In the presence of all of my crew, the bellower would continue. Columbus, embroidered across the front of his hat. I ask you to bear solemn witness that I am taking possession of this island for their lord and lady, the king and the queen, and I will call this island, in all her glory, after our sovereigns Ferdinand and Isabella, Ferdin Ease Island. And oh, the glorious heat of the sun that circles our God-given earth, Furnace Island, then. Kids would clap. I imagine the adults, too, cheering. Lo and behold, sir! One of the hatted crew members would put his arm around Columbus's shoulders. Natives! Finally, every head would turn to the beach. The beach where we waited. They'd see a cluster of women gather slowly to face them. Just the local women. No flown in from the state's staff with skin lighter than our driest sand. Why?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.